This is the first video in my three tool build series. These are really simple woodworking projects that anybody can complete using just three tools.
And the three tools are laid out right here. You've got a tape measure, a handsaw, and a power drill. It doesn't necessarily have to be cordless. You could use a corded drill. I'm building a cubby slash coat rack here, and it came in 33.5 inches wide, which means I'm gonna build it at 32.5 inches wide. That'll just give it a little more room on either side. And in my sketch, you can see I've got a top piece, a bottom piece, those two are identical, and then three simple dividers that will create two cubbies. It's got a back on it, and then there's a separate board down below, which is kind of a floater, and that will house the coat hooks. I think I've got four of those guys. And the whole thing attaches to a couple backer boards. You'll see that's kind of optional. I did that for a couple reasons here that work for my space, but you could always leave those out. All right, so I got going on a 8-foot piece of pine, and this guy's 12 inches wide. 12 inch wide pine is really nice because it gives you the depth for those cubbies. And you can see I started to use my saw as a square edge. That usually works, but this one is out of whack. Using it from both directions, I was able to see that my line wasn't square. So another way to draw a perfectly square line is just to measure your distance on one edge of the board, measure it again on the other edge of the board, and then draw your line. And here I used the saw as a straight edge instead of as a square, and it worked really well. Then I just cut on the line. Now technically that shortens the wood up just a little bit less than 32.5, but for this application it's just fine. And I use my first piece of cut wood to measure the next one. That way the two will be just the same size. Now if you haven't used a handsaw before, just start kind of slow and get your cut going, and then go with a regular motion. You'll get the swing of it, and actually it makes a really nice cut. It's comparable to a power saw in a lot of ways. All right, so I've got the two long pieces cut. It didn't take too long. And I got some gloves on, and that works pretty well to smooth up your wood. You could, of course, use sandpaper, but you'd be surprised how productive a pair of gloved hands can be. Next thing to do was to get going cutting those dividers for the cubbies. These guys are 10 inches high. 10 inches just kind of seemed to work for my shoes and my space. You could, again, go higher for boots or lower for sandals. It's really up to you. All right, so I've got all the pieces for the cubbies put together, and everything in this project is going to be attached with screws. You can see I got 2-inch screws and a drill bit, and you can see in the diagram why I did that. When you're drilling these holes, you're going through the top board that's lying flat, and then the one beneath it that you're attaching it to, which is vertical. These drilled holes are about 1.5 inches in depth. That means that that last 1/2 inch or so of the screw gets to bite into fresh, undrilled wood. And to affix it all together, I just laid it out on my deck, and those pieces kind of balanced on their own. Then I set my top piece in place. You just need to make sure it's in exactly the right position before drilling your holes. And you can see it wiggled a little bit back and forth. That's not a big deal, as long as when you screw your screws in, everything's in the right place. One more small note, you can see a knot in the middle there. I did not drill through the knot. The reason for that is that screws, when they go into knots, will sometimes crack the wood. And at the other end, it's the same deal. Just drill your holes and set your screws, making sure that the pieces all align just perfectly. The awesome thing about using screws is that they don't just attach two pieces together, they actually pull them together. So if your wood has a little bit of warp or twist to it, a screw will often pull it tight and make everything fit just right. And on the other side, it was pretty much the same deal, only now I need to set that centerpiece. So I got to measuring just to make sure it was even on both sides, made some marks, and then was able to set the centerpiece in place and make sure the whole thing was square and even. Now when you're screwing these screws in, you don't want to go too deep. If you go in too deep, it'll kind of crack the wood a little bit, and it's just not necessary. Instead, you want to screw in kind of slowly and bring that head right down to the face, maybe a micro nanometer below the face of the wood, but not too deep. All right, so the centerpiece got a couple of screws on either side. And again, it's kind of measuring to make sure it was right in the right spot. And with those screws, that is the cubby. The cubby is put together. The next thing to do is to put a back on it. This is 6-inch wide pine board, another 8-foot piece. And I just sized it in place. It's always nice to measure things in place. They just end up perfect if you measure them in place. Now the back serves two purposes. One is to create a back so that things don't slide through the shelf. But the other is to stiffen and square up the piece. When you're building a box like this, it can end up kind of wiggling and becoming out of square, out of true. But if you put a back on it, it becomes really stiffened up and solid. Okay, so that is the carcass of the cubbies, all put together and looking pretty good. The next thing to do is just to size a piece for the hooks down below. And that's the remaining piece of that 6-inch wide pine, and I just had to measure and cut a couple inches off the bottom of it. So this is the backer board, it just has two pieces. And again, as I mentioned before, it's kind of optional. You don't necessarily have to use it, but in my case, it just brings the shelf a little bit further out from the wall, which is nice. And I have a piece of conduit on my wall, which you'll see, and it allows me to get around the conduit. And the first thing I did is attach one of these pieces of backer board and put that up square on the wall. I didn't need to use a level because my joists and my wall are level, but in your case, you might need to use a level, which would bring you up to 4 tools on this project. And the nice thing about starting with this bottom piece, this is where the hooks are gonna go, is that then the cubbies can kind of rest on it. The cubbies are a little bit more heavy and awkward, and I screwed them in through the back to the backer board, and it's all set for the hooks. You got to take some time measuring exactly where you want your hooks. You want them to be equidistant apart and the right distance from the bottom. You also want some room around them when you're hanging stuff on the hooks. Now, I bought these hooks at Lowe's because I like the way they each have 3 hooks, so you can really hang a bunch of stuff here. There are a million types of hooks out there. Pick the ones you like. You can even make your own with tree branches or all kinds of different things. The hooks can be the defining feature of a coat rack like this. So pick ones that you like and that really work for you.
All right, thanks for checking out the project. The whole purpose of this series is just to emphasize that you can build pretty cool functional stuff for your house using just a few tools and not a whole lot of experience. You could, of course, paint a shelf like this, stain it, sand it, and dress it up with all kinds of features, but it's actually pretty cool the way it is. It's functional, minimal, and it gets the job done. Hit me with a comment down below. I'm always into seeing your perspective and hearing from people. Also, if you haven't subscribed to the channel, you can do so down below, and that way you will be alerted when I post my next video. All right, in the meantime, go make something cool, and I will see you in the next build video.